today and worshiping with us. As you can see, we have the joy and the privilege to begin our worship service with baptism. I do want to say before I talk about baptism here in just a moment that if you are a guest here with us today, you'll notice that we don't have anything out in the pews right now as far as guest cards or visitor cards or anything like that. So I'm asking you if you'll do me a favor. If you will, just send an email, if you're ready to do this, if you're ready to take this step, if you'll send an email to John, J-O-H-N, at mycbcc.org. It's a mouthful, I know. J-O-H-N at mycbcc.org, and I can answer any questions you might have about the church, or you can send us a Facebook message as well. But most of all, thank you for worshiping with us today. Now, what you're about to see here in just a moment is baptism, and you'll notice as, you know, this is really how we define ourselves as Baptists. This is an important thing we do. What you're going to see here is a physical representation of a spiritual reality. And that is the moment a person repents of their sin and places their faith in Jesus Christ as Lord, they are buried with him in baptism and then raised to walk in newness of life. That's why we baptize the way we do. That's why the New Testament prescribes it the way that it happens. You'll see the candidate go all the way under the water, having been buried with him in baptism. Then as you see them coming up, it represents the fact that they have been raised to walk in newness of life. Now, today is unique. And so we only have one candidate today. So, Pam, if you want to come on down, I'm going to put my mask on real quick. And now, muffled. But before I baptize Pam, I want to remind you of what led her to this point. And that is, having made a profession of faith as a very young child and dealing with uncertainty for 40-something years. This summer, she got under conviction, realized that she had not repented of her sins and placed her faith in Christ. And so today, we're baptizing a church member who has come to faith in Christ. So it's just a wonderful thing, a great way. And let me say this. There are probably some of you who are watching, who are sitting out here, who you've gone through the motions, but Christ is not actually your Lord and Savior. And Pam is a perfect example of what that means and the joy that comes from somebody finally surrendering their life to Christ. Well, Pam, I want to ask you one question. Have you repented of your sins and placed your faith in Jesus Christ as Lord? All right, well, I baptize you as my new sister in Christ in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. All right, as we worship together, would you stand with us as we sing, Fairest Lord Jesus. says, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind you will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way that you think. Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect."
Amen, Will. Thank you, Adam. And as we continue to worship, we're going to sing one of the great songs of Thanksgiving, My Tribute. And would you stand once again as we sing?
Let's pray for the ministry of Operation Christmas Child. We are in collection week still. We have a collection time this afternoon from 2 to 4. And our final one is tomorrow morning from 9 to 11. We could use some help loading shoebox cartons. So anybody available tomorrow morning, 9 a.m. to 11 a.m., we could use your help in the gym. Okay? Do I see any hands out there? Anybody? Okay. Well, all them hands. So just talk to me after the service. Okay? But I'm just praising the Lord that we can still receive shoeboxes in this kind of year and all that we're going through right now. So thank you to everyone who's had a part in that, okay? But why don't we pray together at this time? Father God, we recognize this morning that you are the giver of every good and perfect gift. Father, I thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins. Lord, it's the only reason we can even come and worship before you right now is because of the gift of your Son. We do pray for the ministry of Operation Christmas Child. I'm so thankful for the way that shoeboxes are going to go out from all places and to all the world and that the gospel will be shared. Father, my heart is just moved to know that there'll be unreached people groups that will hear the gospel for the first time because of this kind of ministry. And Father, I pray that you would be with children and families as they hear the gospel, that they would be saved and that they'd be discipled. And Father, we just pray through it all that you would indeed receive the glory, not only through this ministry, but through our church and especially in this service. We pray that you'd empower Brother John as he preaches your word. And Lord, we want to see the lost saved here. And we want, as believers, to grow to be more like Christ. Help us to do that now. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. All right, at this time we're going to invite our children to go to children's church. So we'll meet you at the back of the sanctuary.
Thank you.
interesting. Psalm 23, you ever think about how old that actually is? It's 3,000 years old. David was about 1,000 years before Jesus. And it's been about 2,000 years since Christ was rounding here on the earth. That's a those are 3,000-year-old words that the Lord has used to comfort people and to bring people into a place of worship. That's a long time. And so I love that version of it, guys. Thank you. I hate to do this before a sermon, but I need to make a couple of announcements. I didn't have my notes in front of me for the baptism, and I didn't want to take away from that either. So let me do a little housekeeping before we get started. Next Sunday morning, we will have, at the end of service, a special called business meeting. And it will be for you guys to hear a recommendation coming from an ordination council. This afternoon, we have an ordination council set up to ordain Adam. And so you'll be hearing that recommendation, hopefully, assuming he passes, next Sunday. So that'll be at the end of service. We'll be bringing that. We'll have that coming then. So there'll be a called business meeting at the end of service next week. For those of you who are involved in the Tuesday night Bible study, the Tuesday morning Bible study, that will not happen this week. Most likely it'll start back after Thanksgiving. But Miss Nancy wanted me to let you guys know that that's not happening this week. And then do remember there's no Wednesday night this week because it is the day before Thanksgiving. So we won't be back together till next Sunday. So let's make a hard transition into the sermon. Those are always fun. Probably early when you were young, when you were a kid, had your first job, maybe first or second job. You ever have one of those jobs where you don't have a lot of really important responsibility? Like your job is important for things to happen, but you're really not held accountable for a lot. One of my jobs I had in college was like this. I worked at a place over there on Shelby Oaks, and it was electrical insulation. We converted electrical insulation into there were these rolls. They were 36 inches long and usually about 18 inches in diameter. And my job was to put them on the back of the machine, to feed them through the machine, and then after they were cut down to smaller rolls, I boxed them up. Now, it was really interesting. The guys who ran the machines, it had to be super precise. Because there was a tolerance for these things. They would take these 36-inch rolls and sometimes cut them down to, an eighth of an inch size, throughout the whole thing, and then we would ship that off. And so once I put my stuff on the back, there was a shaft that went through the roll, and then I would fill it up with air, and it would the thing had some ridges that would pop out, so that'd keep it in place, and I'd put it through, then I was done. And then they'd get the cutting process started, and they'd let it run a few revolutions, and then they'd stop the machine. And our manager would come by with a set of calipers, and he would have to go to every one of them and see if it was in tolerance. And if it wasn't, it was that guy's fault. It was the guy running the machine's fault. He hadn't set the thing up right. Now, me, nobody ever looked at me and said, well, why weren't these within tolerance? I had nothing to do with it. I never got the blame when any of that kind of stuff happened. But I did have a job in that. And my job was to do the grunt work, to do the mindless thing, which I was pretty good at mindless stuff, to put that on the back and then to put it all in the box later. But as far as the ultimate responsibility, as far as the thing that counted goes, I had nothing to do with that. Now, maybe you've had jobs like that where you're sort of you're the person that swept the floor, or you're the person that did whatever. We all have those things in high school and, when we're young and that sort of deal. Now, you say, what's he talking about? Where is he going with all this? Here's the thing. What you and I need to understand is that within the kingdom of God, and the way God brings about the expansion of his kingdom, we are not responsible for the results. We can't do anything about the results. We only have one responsibility, and that is simply to obey and get the word of God out there. And that's all we can do. You and I can never force anyone to come to faith in Christ. We can never trick anybody into being saved. All we can do is get the gospel out there to tell them about the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, and tell them that if they'll repent of their sins and place their faith in Jesus, they'll be saved. But that's it. That's all we can do. Let me show you a couple of verses before we even get to our text today. Our main marching orders are Matthew 28, 18 through 20. This is the ending of Matthew's gospel. It says, "And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, 'All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you, and lo, I'm with you always, even to the end of the age.'" That's our command, to go and to make disciples. Romans 10:17 goes into it as well. It says, "So faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ." It is our job simply to get the word out there. It is our job to simply do those things that have to take place for disciples to be made. But we are not responsible for how people respond to that. That's up to God. And that's up to their own hardness of heart or softness of heart or wherever they fall. In fact, I'm going to give you the point of the sermon up front. Don't check out on me, but here's the point. It's a simple one. Obedience is our job, not outcomes. Obedience is our job, not outcomes. So I want you to see, I want you to take your Bibles, turn to Acts chapter 17 and verse 1. And we're going to see different reactions to the gospel. And yet, in the middle of all those different reactions, we see Paul and his companions simply be obedient to what God has called them to do. So Acts chapter 17, we are on the second missionary journey with Paul. He and Silas and some other traveling companions, Luke seems to be with them at this point. They were originally going to be in what we know as Turkey today, and the Lord then called them over to Europe. And the gospel gets to Europe for the first time. And you remember, they end up in Philippi. And there in Philippi, they see some people come to Christ, and a jailer and his family get saved, and there's a jailbreak, and all kinds of stuff goes on there in Philippi. Stories we're very familiar with. Well, they have now moved on. They're now heading a little further west, about 100 miles. And they first come to the town of Thessalonica, which is still around, by the way. Thessaloniki is still a city. You can Google it and see where it is. It's still there. It's a large place. And so they come to Thessalonica. I'm just going to read a few verses at a time as we walk through it. Acts chapter 17, verse 1. It says, "Now when they had traveled through a path..." Sorry, y'all, I practiced this all week and then I messed it up. I got nervous. That city right there. Amphipolis. There it is. I nailed it. When I went over this morning, I nailed it. Y'all just make me nervous. Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where there was a synagogue of the Jews. This is what Paul does. He always goes to the synagogue first. Because if you go to the synagogue first, they have been anticipating the Messiah. They know the Hebrew scriptures. They know all of these things. They are the ones closest to taking that step of placing their faith in Jesus. So he always goes there first. Verse 2, "According to Paul's custom, he went to them, and for 3 Sabbaths, so 3 weeks, reasoned with them from the scriptures." So for 3 weeks in a row, he goes on Saturday, on the Sabbath, to tell them about Jesus. And Luke here tells us what he says, verse 3, "explaining and giving evidence that the Christ had to suffer and rise again from the dead, saying, 'This Jesus, whom I am proclaiming to you, is the Christ.'" So Paul comes in and he goes to his own people, to the Hebrews, to the Jews. He knows their scriptures. They might know him by reputation. And he goes in and he begins to tell them that the Messiah that they've heard about all of their life, that their parents and their grandparents and their great-grandparents told them about, the Messiah that they've been anticipating, that Jesus is that Messiah. In fact, let me give you a couple of verses that he would have shared with them most likely, because they're quoted all throughout the New Testament. Psalm 2, verses 1 and 3, it says, "Why are the nations in an uproar, and the peoples devising a vain thing? The kings of the earth take their stand, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed," that's the word Messiah, "saying, 'Let us tear their fetters apart and cast away their cords from us.'" And then down in verse 7 of Psalm 2, "I will surely tell of the decree of the Lord. He said to me, 'You are my son. Today I have begotten you.'" So Paul would have gone in and he would have said, "Let me tell you about this man, Jesus." And he would have talked about how he was God in the flesh, how the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, as John would have put it. And he would have said, "Jesus came into this world and he performed miracles. And he lived a sinless life. And he fulfilled Scripture. And he went to the cross and he died for you. And he was buried and he rose again on the third day." And then he would have told them, "If you'll repent of your sins and place your faith in Christ as Lord, Because that's how he puts it in Acts chapter 20, of repentance toward God and faith in our Lord Jesus Christ. If you will call on the name of the Lord, you'll be saved. He would have been telling them this week after week, at least for 3 weeks. And would have been explaining from many other places, just from Psalm 2, from Isaiah 53, Genesis 3:16, from the whole sacrificial system, all those things that pointed to Jesus. He would have been able to say, this is the Messiah. This is who you've been waiting on. And look what happens. Verse 4. And some of them were persuaded. So some people got saved and joined Paul and Silas, along with a large number of God-fearing Greeks and a number of the leading women. So some of the Jews heard and were convinced and got under conviction and called on the name of the Lord and were saved. And then some of the God-fearing Greeks who had rejected paganism and were following the God of the Hebrews, the God of the Jews, had recognized that he was the true God. Now they're hearing the fulfillment of all that. And so they're surrendering their life to Christ, so they're getting saved. And it says a large number of leading women, so prominent people in a very prominent city, are coming to faith in Christ. Well, Satan doesn't like that. Verse 5. But the Jews, becoming jealous and taking along some wicked men from the marketplace, formed a mob and set the city in an uproar, and attacking the house of Jason, they were seeking to bring them out to the people. Whenever your influence, whenever your power is threatened, people will show who they are. And those who had rejected Paul's message, those who had rejected that Christ was the Messiah, when they saw people coming to faith in Christ, when they saw people who were part of their synagogue suddenly becoming Christians, they got real jealous. Because now they've joined another group. Now they've gone another way. Now they're following a different path. You and I know they're following the correct path, the true path. But now they're jealous. Their influence, probably their finances are going to be impacted as well. So they get a mob together. So we're going to take care of these folks. And they go to the house of a fella called Jason. We don't know anything about him. He just pops up here. He was there. Apparently he had invited them into his home. Verse 6, when they did not find them, they began dragging Jason and some brethren before the city authorities, shouting. Now, before I even read it, you know the reason they're upset is because they're jealous. We've been told that. Scripture has just told us that. But listen to what they said. These men who have upset the world have come here also, and Jason has welcomed them. And they all act contrary to the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, Jesus. What do? They appeal to the Roman authorities and say, these guys are causing political problems. These guys are trying to say that we shouldn't hail Caesar, that we shouldn't follow Caesar, that we should follow this other king, this fellow named Jesus that they keep talking about. Well, those same things that they tried to claim about Jesus. You know, Jesus would talk about his kingdom, that his kingdom was not of this world, and that he is the king, that he is the Messiah. But Jesus also talked about render to Caesar the things that are Caesar's. And so people took his words and twisted them and made it sound like he was a political insurrectionist. And that's the exact same thing they're doing here. We know the full teaching of the New Testament. We know Paul's teachings about submission to government. We just looked at it a few weeks ago, right after the election. So we know that what they're saying isn't true, but they took their words and made a half-truth and a whole lie out of it and said they're causing trouble. They're trying to get the city to revolt against Caesar. Verse 8, they stirred up the crowd and the city authorities who heard these things. And when they had received a pledge from Jason, that's a bond payment, he had to pay him some money, and others, they released them. So they had arrested Jason and some other people and had dragged them in front, and Jason and them had to pay so they could say, look, everything's going to be fine. There's not going to be any more trouble. And then ultimately, they're going to send Paul and Silas on to a different city. So here in Thessalonica, some people get saved, and yet there are people who get angry and jealous and try to stir up trouble. Remember what I said, that obedience is our job, not outcome. So let's travel about 50 miles to the next city, Berea. Berea is an interesting city. Berea is off the beaten path. In fact, one poet back then, or one ancient writer, said it's a town off the beaten track. It's out in the middle of nowhere. It's not on one of the main Roman roads. It's a little town. They're big enough, though, to have a synagogue. So they go to Berea, verse 10. The brethren immediately sent Paul and Silas away by night to Berea. And when they arrived, look what they did. They went into the synagogue of the Jews. Same thing he does everywhere. This is his pattern. This is what he does. Now listen to the description. Now these were more noble-minded than those in Thessalonica, for they received the word with great eagerness, examining the scriptures daily to see whether these things were so. That's why you will see, as you drive around, you will see Berean Baptist Church. That's why we have a Sunday school class here in the church, the Berean Baptist class, the Berean Sunday school class. It's a recognition that these folks listened to what Paul and Silas had to say, and then did the thing that you should do every time I get up here and preach, and every time your Sunday school teacher preaches, anytime you're listening to preaching or watching or whatever, they went and examined the scriptures for themselves to make sure what was being said was correct. And notice how they were doing it. They weren't just doing it on the Sabbath. Look at the verse again. It says, with great eagerness, examining the scriptures daily. So every day, to see whether these things were so. They would have gone back. Let's see. Okay, he mentioned Psalm 2. Let's go back. Could that be Jesus? He mentioned Isaiah 53. Let's pull that up. Yeah, that sounds like him. What about Psalm 22? Psalm 22, by the way, if you ever go, the choir sang Psalm 23. Read Psalm 22 sometime. It's simply a description of the crucifixion. Years, hundreds of years before crucifixion's even invented. So they would have gone to these verses, and they would have studied them, and they would have heard what Paul said, and they would have seen the testimony of his life. And look what happens, verse 12. Therefore, many of them believed. Well, of course they did. They were studying in God's word. In Luke 16:31, and I added this verse this morning, so we don't have it on the slide. In Luke 16:31, the parable of Lazarus and the rich man. It says, if they did not listen to Moses and the prophets, they will not be persuaded even if someone rises from the dead. In other words, it is the scripture that gets into people. It is the scripture that God uses to draw people. That's why we've been told to get the gospel out there. And as they're in the scripture all week, many of them come to faith in Christ. I'll read the verse again, verse 12. Therefore, many of them believed, along with a number of prominent Greek women and men, so more influential people. But look what happens. 100 miles away, or 50 miles away, they get word. But when the Jews of Thessalonica found out that the word of God had been proclaimed by Paul in Berea also, they came there as well, agitating and stirring up the crowds. They were so put out that they heard that 50 miles away, these people they thought they'd gotten rid of have gone to another town and are doing it again, and they're going to travel 50 miles. Now, that's not easy back then. It's going to take you a little while to do it. It's not like they could hop in their car and just head on. So this is a firm decision. You know, a lot of people probably didn't even travel 50 miles from home their whole life back then. But they're going to go to Berea, this little small town, and cause some more trouble. Because that's what they want to do. Oppose the gospel. Verse 14. Then immediately the brethren sent Paul out as far as the sea. And Silas and Timothy remained there. That's important. They're going to stay there. And so Paul's going to be by himself. Verse 15. Now those who escorted Paul brought him as far as Athens. And receiving a command for Silas and Timothy to come to him as soon as possible, they left. And we'll leave Paul in Athens. We'll pick up with him in Athens next week, because it's one of the most important sermons that he's going to preach in all of the book of Acts. Is he's there by himself in a pagan city and these folks don't know anything about the Hebrew scriptures. They don't know anything. And so we see him preach to people who you know, don't know anything about the gospel. It's a fascinating sermon that we'll get to. But notice the difference going on here. He gets to Thessalonica, and yes, some people get saved. Things are good, but suddenly the people get jealous, and they stir up trouble, and they go in, and they grab Jason, and they drag him out. They go 50 miles away to Berea, and the people hear it, and they study the scriptures, and they come to faith in Christ. And the folks in Berea were fine. Things were going great. And those folks from Thessalonica decided to come in and just mess everything up. See, in both cities, Paul and Silas were simply doing what God had called them to do. And that is to get the gospel out there. I wrote this down just to make sure I read it to you so I can get it right. Our job is to share Christ, knowing we cannot control whether people respond with faith or react with anger. See, we can't control whether people respond with faith or react with anger, because what does the gospel do? What's the first thing that for a person to be saved, they have to come to the realization that they're a sinner and they're separated from God. And that's a humbling thing to do, to admit that you're less than you probably thought you were before you came to that understanding. See, the gospel is very clear that this is the only way. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The gospel says this is the only way to have eternal life. You can't sit on the fence, in other words. And people either respond with faith, or they often respond with anger and fear, and they cause trouble. But you and I can't control them. I cannot make anybody respond with faith, and I should never present the gospel in a way that somebody who's spiritually hardened might not respond with anger. Because if you just put the words out there in a loving, kind way, there's a good chance if they're hard-hearted enough, they're going to get mad. Because you're going to have to look them right in the eye and say, you're a sinner. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and you're a sinner. I'm sure I've told you all this story. I had to, but it's a good example. So y'all just pretend like you've never heard it before. All right, and tell me later. That's the best story I ever heard. No, don't do that. I was serving at my first church. I had a funeral one day, and a funeral home there in Bartlett had called. Family didn't have a pastor. They weren't associated with our church at all. Can we have the funeral at your place? Will you do the funeral? Sure. So I did that. I met with the family and talked to them and all of that. And so I'm up there in my own church, which is full. It's the fullest I ever saw it. We had 22 pews. And 100 people, and everybody was shoulder to shoulder, and there was about 100 in there that day. We were running about 20 on Sunday. It was weird to see this on like a Tuesday afternoon, right? And I didn't know anybody else in the building, right? I'm in my own church, packed, didn't know anybody. That I must have belonged there, because several people would ask me things like, where's the water fountain and where's the restroom? They must have known that they thought I worked for the funeral home, but preachers tend to look like that anyway. So I get up there, and I say it, and to this day, I hadn't planned on saying this, but here's what I told them. I said, because I'd gotten to the part in the sermon where I was going to share the gospel. I always share the gospel during a funeral, because everybody's thinking about eternal things anyway, as they ought to. And I told this group of people, I said, look, I don't know any of y'all in here, but I know this. I know every one of you are sinners. And there are a lot of unchurched people in there. And y'all, they went, and I thought, well, that's not the reaction I was looking for. Because if I say that in here, we're like, yeah, that's right. I'm a sinner saved by grace. But, I mean, they were like, what did he just call us? I mean, they were really kind of like upset about it. But it's the truth. And I said it in a nice way. I wasn't like, you know, spitting and shouting and pointing at them and stuff. I was walking through the gospel, lad. You've got to deal with that point. And when you do that, when you tell people about Jesus and why he had to die and who he is, you don't know how they're going to respond. Are they going to be offended? Are they going to be angry? Are they going to tell you to get out? What are they going to do? You and I can't control that. All we can do is share. And God's going to take care of the results. Paul and Silas just went and shared, and God took care of the results. So let's go back to the point of the sermon. Obedience is our job, not outcomes. Let me give you a couple of verses here. John 6:44. John 6, by the way, one of the great chapters in all the Bible. It's great. Here's what Jesus says. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. The Holy Spirit has to get a hold of somebody. And you and I are not the Holy Spirit. God does that. Acts 2:37, you see how it works out. After Peter had preached on the day of Pentecost, the crowd says, now when they had heard this, they were pierced to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, brethren, what shall we do? They responded, they were under conviction, and they knew they needed to be saved. So I'm going to give you two things to think about this week. You and I cannot control how people are going to respond to the gospel. But we can pray for God to soften their heart. We can pray for God to work in their life. We can pray for God to prepare them to hear the gospel so that when they hear it, they respond with faith. We can't make them, but we can pray for them. So I want to challenge you on this. This week's Thanksgiving. I don't know if y'all knew that. Go to the grocery store today. You'll remember. I went to the grocery store yesterday. It was a nightmare. I don't recommend it. But we're in Thanksgiving season. You're probably going to see people you hadn't seen in a while, if you're gathering together. You're going to see people in your family that maybe you know they're lost, and you're burdened for them. Maybe it's a nephew, maybe it's a child, maybe it's a parent, maybe it's a grandparent, maybe it's a sibling, a cousin. You know they're lost, and you know you're going to see them. I want to challenge you this week, starting today, pray for that person leading up to when you're going to see them by name every day. Pray for the Lord to soften their heart. Pray for the Lord to convict them of sin and of righteousness and judgment. Pray for God to do a work in their life. Pray for the Holy Spirit to get a hold of them and begin to draw them and convict them. And then pray for the opportunity for you to share with them. You say, well, I don't know how to share the gospel. Listen, if you've been saved, you know how to share the gospel because all you have to do is tell them what Jesus did for you. You know what he did. He died for you and he's buried and he rose again on the third day. I say it every week. Every preacher you've ever heard says it every week. You know what happened. And you know that you asked him to save you. Tell him about it. Pray for him this week and then tell him. Maybe there are other people in your life. Maybe you have neighbors. Maybe you have others around you that you get to interact with and you know they're lost. Begin to pray for them. And pray for the Lord to open doors for you to share your faith with them. Because all we're called to do is be obedient. That's all we're called to do. The results are not up to us. Those things are up to God. But you and I have been commanded to share the gospel, to make disciples. So I want you to begin to think about people specifically and begin to pray for them specifically and look for those opportunities, especially these next few days as we come into the Thanksgiving season. If you're here today and you've realized in the middle of all this that you don't know him, maybe when Pam was in the baptistry earlier, you realized that you're in the same place she was, that you're a member of this church. Or maybe you're a visitor today and you're a member of another church and you've realized you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior. The message that Paul and Silas preached is the same message that I'm preaching today and that has never changed, and that is Jesus Christ is Lord and that he died for you. And if you will call on his name, if you will repent of your sins and place your faith in Jesus, you will be saved. Do you need to be saved today? Do you need to respond with faith and not anger? So here's what we're going to do. We're going to go into a time of invitation here in just a moment. We're going to shut down Facebook here in just a second. I want to talk to those of you who are watching. If you need to talk about these things further, send an email to me, John, J-O-H-N, at mycbcc.org, J-O-H-N, at mycbcc.org. You can send the email to me. You can send a Facebook message to the church. The only people that will see it are the administrators on the Facebook page, so it'll stay within that very small group. We can talk further about what it means to give your life to Christ. Or if you just need us to pray for you, or there's somebody, a lost person you know that you want us to pray for, send us that name, and we'll pray for them this week. But Adam's going to log this off now, and then we'll go